So this will actually be interesting for you, or could be interesting because it will be mainly about diagonalizing non-symmetric matrices. Okay. So I think it's actually quite close to Okay, so today, so this is the last lecture, and today I'm in some sense I'm going to come back to the very beginning of the course when we were talking about these very simple deterministic models that were based on differential equations, except that now we're going to take into account the specific structure of the space of genetic types that I've been discussing. So we're going to look at these deterministic models. But with sort of living on the sequence space. And this will give rise to a new phenomenon, which is called the error threshold, and which is quite famous in this field, and that I wanted to try to explain to you. And so in some sense, this discussion is sort of complementary to what I did on Tuesday, in the sense that we're now looking at very large populations. So effectively, you're taking the population size to infinity, right? So this, in my column, this is chapter 5, and it's called mutation selection dynamics. And so the idea is that we consider dynamics on the sequence space. In the limit when the population size goes to infinity, and so the fluctuations that come from the finite population size are absent, so we have in the jargon of this context that there is no genetic drift, okay, so everything is deterministic. So basically, we're going to look at mutation selection models similar to what we did in the very first lecture. So, but now we're going to put them on the hypercube. So we're going to look at mutation selection models on the space of binary sequences. And so, recall from lecture 1 so there we were looking at these differential equations. So basically we were looking at the differential equation for the frequency of a certain type. So the dynamics of type frequencies xi. So xi is the frequency of type I. And they have some fitnesses and there are some mutation rates. And so in general, these dynamics are given by simple differential equations. So you have the selection term. So Ri is the fitness or the growth rate of type I. This phi is this quantity that makes sure that the normalization is maintained. So we have the sum over the types. I should always be equal to 1, so this is why we have this thing here. So this is selection. Right. Selection. And then we have some mutation matrix. So we have mutations. So type J mutates into type I, and that contributes then to the type I. So this is the mutation term. Okay, so these U's are some mutation matrix. And then we in order to keep this keep the total, the sum of these frequencies constant, we need this phi to be equal to the mean fitness. So phi of t is equal to the sum over the types of ri xi. And this makes these equations formally nonlinear, right? So there's a nonlinearity because the phi actually depends on these xi's, but as we also discussed in the first lecture, this nonlinearity is sort of irrelevant because it can be transformed away. Okay, so in fact, we're actually dealing with a linear problem. So the nonlinearity due to this phi of t can be transformed away. This has been known in this context for a long time. So essentially, you can imagine if you didn't have this phi term, then of course the sum of the xi's would grow exponentially, but the dynamics would be the same under this equation as if you just let everything grow exponentially and normalize it at the end, because the relative frequencies don't actually care about this this phi term. So the transformation that one can make to sort of eliminate this nonlinearity. Maybe I'll write it down here. So this can be transformed away in the following sense by introducing these unnormalized frequencies. So Zi of t, which is just the exponential of so the integral over this mean fitness. Right, so I just multiply this with the exponential over the integral of the mean fitness, and then I find that the z's actually, so the z's satisfy the same equation but without the phi. So then zi dot is equal to ri zi plus sum over j uji zj. So this is now the same problem as before, but it doesn't have this nonlinearity. I mean, this is easy enough to check. You just insert this into that equation. You see that the xi satisfy exactly the same. So this can be, so we're actually dealing with the linear problem, right? So this is sort of the equation that we actually have to deal with. This is a general form of a mutation selection equation or mutation selection dynamics. And of course, you can write, you know, the right hand side is just some matrix multiplying these z's. So essentially, what you have to understand are just the spectral properties of this matrix.
The goal is to characterize fixed point and stabilities.
Well, actually, because it's a linear problem, there's a unique stationary state, and essentially the goal is to characterize a stationary state. So that's what we're going to do. The right hand side is some matrix. So for long times, this dynamics will just converge to the eigenvector corresponding to the largest eigenvalue of that matrix. And this is the object that we want to study. Okay, and we'll see that this eigenvector sort of displays a non-trivial phenomena as a function of the mutation vector. Now.
Okay.
Okay. But before doing that, we want to specify the model a bit further. So we want to introduce the actual sequence-based structure. Thank you. So we introduce a sequence space. And I'm going to use the same notation that I've used before. So basically, these xi's will now be, or the zi's actually, we don't really need to consider the xi's anymore. So the zi's will be replaced by these quantities, which I call z of sigma and t, where sigma is a sequence in the sequence space, right? So sigma is a binary sequence. It has some sequence like L. And these ri's, of course, become the fitness values that we have had before. So ri is just the fitness. And the mutation scheme will be to consider point mutations. So we just look at point mutations in these binary sequences. So we have the mutation matrix is the following. So the assumption is that point mutations occur at rate mu per site. And so the matrix is Uij. I'm going to write this now as a quantity gamma. So this is the rate at which the sequence sigma mutates to sequence sigma prime. And this is equal to mu if the two sequences are at distance 1. All right, so nearest neighbor mutations take place at rate mu. It's 0 if they are further away. But in order to, so this is something that I didn't mention before. So this matrix U, in order to keep everything normalized, this matrix U has a property that the diagonal values are the negative sums of the off-diagonal values. So there's a kind of normalization condition here on the U, which is that Uii is equal to minus the sum of J not equal to I of Uji. And that means that when sigma is equal to sigma prime, this has to be minus L times mu. So this mutation matrix has a diagonal term which is negative in order to preserve probability, right? Because everything that mutates away also has to come back, so to speak. Okay. Is that clear? Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's the model. So essentially, it contains the fitness landscape in the form of this S-F function, and it contains a mutation rate and a sequence length. And so then the model is simply Z dot is equal to a matrix multiplication, so I'm going to write this as C of sigma sigma prime, so this is my C matrix, so to speak. Maybe we give it a hat, C of sigma T, so this is a simple linear problem where the C matrix has a diagonal piece which comes from the fitness, so this F of sigma times delta of sigma sigma prime, plus the gamma matrix, which is a mutation matrix. So this is the model. And what we're interested in is the behavior for long times, okay? And now this matrix has a property that in principle, you know, under sufficiently many transitions, every state can be transformed into any other state, so it's irreducible. And so one knows from sort of general theorems that for long times the solution will converge to the largest of the eigenvector with the largest eigenvalue. So that's something called the Probabilistic theorem, which basically tells you that for t going to infinity, the solution to this equation will be everything will sort of grow exponentially with some eigenvalue that I call lambda, and it will converge to this corresponding eigenvector, where lambda is the So this is the statement of the Probabilistic theorem. Where lambda is the maximal eigenvalue. This matrix C hat. And that star of sigma is the corresponding eigenvector. And the Probabilistic-Moran theorem also guarantees that this maximal eigenvalue is separated from the rest of the spectrum and things like that. Okay. So this is basically, and in fact, so what is the biological meaning of lambda? So lambda is in fact the fitness of the population at mutation selection balance. So the stationary state. So essentially, you know, we have a kind of a competition in this problem. We have the sequences of high fitness will tend to concentrate the population, and the mutations will drive it away from these concentrated points. So as a result of that balance, there will be something called mutation selection balance, so some stationary distribution will be formed, and this will be described by this eigenvector. And lambda will just be the value of the fitness at that state. Okay, so lambda is in fact, in the notation of before, will be the limit of the mean population fitness for t going to infinity, which was this quantity phi. So this is the mean, this is the fitness of the population. At mutation selection values. Okay, so this is the problem. Why is this interesting or difficult? For one thing, of course, this is a very big eigenvalue problem. So the sequence space has dimension L. There are 2 to the L sequences, so this matrix C hat is 2 to the L by 2 to the L. Right? So it's a big matrix. And so one thing that one would like to do in order to find solutions to this problem is to reduce the dimensionality. And this can be done in general if there is enough symmetry in the fitness landscape. Right? So what we're going to try to do is to reduce the dimensionality of this problem by assuming certain symmetries of the fitness landscape, and then one gets a problem that one can solve more explicitly. But before doing that, let me maybe just mention very briefly the sort of historical roots of this problem. So in the context of population genetics, this kind of model was probably first considered systematically by Krug and Kimura. So in population genetics, this is known as a Krug-Kimura model. It's from the early 1970s. But in the physics community, a different name is sort of more well known, and this goes back to Manfred Eigen. And he studied this in the context of prebiotic evolution. So he was concerned with the question rather than having actual biological species, you look at a chemical soup of macromolecules that are able to replication, self-replicate based on a template. So basically you consider having an RNA string which can sort of replicate itself. And then the question was, how easy is it from such a system to get something like structure formation? And this was then later expanded upon using feedback mechanisms and so-called hypercycle that you might know about. But the first step was this model here. And this is in this context, and so this goes back to Eigen, and in this context they coined the term quasi-species model. So this goes back to Manfred Eigen. 1971. So in the physics literature, this model typically goes under the name of quasi-species model. Now, what does the term quasi-species mean? So it's important to sort of realize that the species here does not refer to biological species. So the way Eigen thought about this was as a problem of chemical reaction kinetics. So each type of molecule is a chemical species. And the insight that they gained from studying this model was that such a system typically does not consist just of a single chemical species, but of a distribution of species. So there's a kind of cloud of species, which is exactly described by this eigenvector here, because this eigenvector tells you how much of the different possible chemical species there are in the system. And so this eigenvector is in fact what Eigen calls a quasi-species. Right? The quasi-species is, in some sense, this eigenvector, the Z star. And the question that Eigen was concerned with, and that we'll also we'll discuss this in a moment, was whether this quasi-species is sort of localized in sequence space, whether it consists mostly of one particular type and maybe a few types around it, or whether it's completely delocalized. And what he showed was that as you increase the mutation rate, there's a kind of phase transition where this eigenvector delocalizes, and that was then interpreted as being a kind of threshold for the mutation rate beyond which the system cannot maintain any biological information. Okay, so that's sort of the context here. Okay, so basically what we want to do is to look at this matrix here for a certain class of this landscapes and for large L. Okay? Is this clear? Just linear differential equations. Okay, so let's see how this works. Okay, so the main phenomenon, as I mentioned already, that we want to understand is the error, the so-called error threshold. Error threshold. And so we're going to, in order to do that, we're going to consider a subclass of Fidmos landscape. So I'm going to reduce the dimensionality. This problem from 2 to the L to L plus 1. We're going to consider, and I think this will actually be for the remainder of the lecture, we'll just stick to those in this case. We'll consider a so-called permutation invariant Fidmos landscapes. And permutation invariant simply means that the fitness only depends on the number of ones in the sequence. It doesn't depend on where they are. Right? So you can basically permutate the sequence without changing the fitness. F of sigma depends only on the number of ones. Sigma. So if you want to write this a little bit more formally, you say that f of sigma is some function small f, which is a function of the distance to the zero sequence, sigma zero being the sequence where n is zero. And so this is the number of ones in the sequence. And the small f is for now an arbitrary function. Now, if we assume this, then of course all the sequences with the same number of ones are sort of under this dynamics equivalent. So we can put them all together into one class. So we can now lump the genotypes into so-called error classes. So you know, the idea is, and I'll be more specific about that later, the idea is that this the state of all zeros is some sort of a perfect sequence, and each one is a kind of error. Right? So generally, we consider a situation where this f is a decreasing function, so the more errors you have, you know, the more deficiencies you have, the smaller the fitness. And so therefore, the sequences with the same number of ones are called error classes. So these are sequences that have the same distance to the zero sequence that we call k, and then pk is just the sum over the frequencies of those in the one error class. So this is just the sum over the z. Well, this actually, I'm going to suppress the time now because we're basically only looking at the stationary state, right? So basically, this is the sum over sigma such that the distance to the zero. State is k. Okay. So this is just a fraction of the population that has k mutations. It's a fraction, or the unnormalized fraction. Okay, I think it's actually, I'll write down this in a moment. I think I want to introduce the normalization again. So let's put an x here. I'm sorry for the confusion. Let's put an x here, and then this is the fraction of the population with k errors. At some point, at this point, it becomes useful to introduce the normalization again. And so the dynamics of this pk now becomes the following, and this is really the main point. So again, we'll have a selection term, right? So this will now be fitness minus mean fitness minus pk. And then we'll have the mutation terms, but the main point here, and this is sort of where the non-symmetric property of this matrix comes in, the dynamics of these pk's, the mutations are no longer symmetric. And so let me write this down. So what we have to put here is there's a term here that contains the gain of sequences with k errors from those with k plus 1 or k minus 1, right? So if I want to, so if I have a sequence with k plus 1 errors, right, then in order to get a sequence with k errors, I have to revert one of those errors, right? So the rate for that will be the mutation rate per site times the number of sites that I can revert, which is just k plus 1. Okay, so this is one term. Then we have a similar term for the sequences that have one error less. And those, of course, have to, in order to get a sequence with k errors from one with k minus 1 errors, I need to mutate one site that has no error so far. And so the term here is mu times l minus k plus 1. Right, so there's l minus k minus 1. So these would be the gain terms. And then, of course, I have all the mutations that take me out of this state. So any, of course, any mutation, if I have a sequence with k errors, any mutation that I make will actually change the number of errors. So I have a loss term here, which is mu times l times k. Okay, so this is now the mutation selection equation for this lumped problem. And you see that here, and this is really sometimes physically the key point here, that because of the structure of the sequence space, this mutation operator is now no longer symmetric. Right? So if you have a small number of, and this is intuitively fairly obvious, I mean, if you have a small number of errors, then almost, you know, most mutations will increase the number of errors, and it will be difficult to decrease the number of errors because you have to hit the right site, right? And vice versa if you have a lot of errors. So this is really, the structure of the sequence space really comes in. So this is now the problem, and so this is of course valid for k equal to 1 up to l minus 1, and at the boundaries, so for k equal to 0 and k equal to l, the corresponding terms that contain k minus 1 or k plus 1 would be absent. So this will look a little bit different at the boundaries. Okay. And the F bar is, of course, again, the mean fitness. F bar is just the sum of K.
Does it make any sense to take some limit, some continuum limit in K, and get an equation diffusion drift?
Yes, this is, I'm doubtful if I, yeah, this is exactly what one does, of course. But I'll explain the main thing first without doing that. But in a sort of more general setting, this is indeed what you would do. You're perfectly right. So if you take a continuum limit, you would get an equation with diffusion and drift. And then in order to extract the stationary state, you want to symmetrize this and so on. And this is really what gives rise to these. So this is the reduced problem, and again we're interested in taking the limit t going to infinity, and we know that then this will become this will go to the stationary state, and this is what we're sort of interested in. So for t going to infinity, you see that pk dot goes to zero, and we have this will become simply the that we have seen. And so in that limit, the problem that we need to solve, and pk, of course, will go to some stationary distribution. And so the eigenvalue problem that we want to solve is now this one. So we have the diagonal term, which contains these two things. Plus uk plus 1 times uk plus 1 plus u times l minus k plus 1 minus uk plus 1. Okay, so there's a problem that we want to solve. So now the simplest thing that one could consider is a so-called single peak fitness landscape. So now at this point we have to sort of specify what the F is. So we're going to look at the so-called single peak fitness landscape. And there the idea is that only the sequence with no errors has a higher fitness, and everybody else has the same fitness, which, because this whole problem is sort of invariant under additions of a constant to F, so the fitness of these other sequences can just be put equal to zero. So we're going to say that this F of k is equal to basically some constant F0 times delta k0. So it's non-zero only when k is equal to zero. Okay. And now we're going to look at the equation for p0. So consider k equal to zero. So if we write down the equation for k equal to zero, we have lambda times k to p0 star, which is equal to f0 minus mu times l times p0 star, and then we have p1. So k is 0, so it's plus mu times p1 star, and this term will be absent because k minus 0 doesn't exist, right? So this is the equation, and lambda is the mean fitness. And the mean fitness obviously is just equal to F0 times P0 star, right? Because the non-zero, the sequences with non-zero numbers of errors have fitness 0, so it's just the F0 times a fraction of the sequences that have 0 errors, okay? So this is in fact a quadratic equation for P0. Now the point is, and this is again this point about the asymmetry, so now let's take L to infinity, or, you know, let's make L large, and then you see that this term here will be much bigger than that. So this term describes that the mutation of the perfect sequence with not only zeros gives me, you know, takes me away from that perfect sequence. So any mutation will increase the distance and will take me away, whereas this is a small term that describes that if I have a sequence with one error, in order to reverse that, I have to hit exactly that side, and that's very unlikely, right? So the point is that when mu becomes large, this second term here can be neglected, so mu p1 star can be neglected. To u l times p0 star. And so we actually have a quadratic equation for P0 star, and we also see that in order to get some reasonable result, so if F0 is some finite fitness advantage, then in order to get a reasonable result for large L, we have to scale the mutation rate to zero. Right? So to get a sort of non-degenerate or non-trivial limit, and this is what one always does in these problems, non-trivial limit. Scale mu to zero, L to infinity. Such that mu times L, so mu times L is now the total mutation rate of the sequence. So this is a probability that mutation happens anywhere in the sequence. And this is a constant which we can call mu. Okay. And so in that limit, we can drop the P1 term. And then we get something very simple. So basically we get, so lambda is F0 times P0 squared. So F0 times P0 squared is equal to x0 minus u times p0 star. So that's the equation that we end up with. And you see that this has two different solutions depending on whether f0 is greater than u or smaller than u. So if f0 is greater than u, then we have a solution. Then we can have a solution of non-zero P0, right? So we can cancel P0 on both sides and we just get P0 star is equal to 1 minus U divided by F0. Whereas if F0 is smaller than U, then the only possible solution is that P0 star is equal to 0. Okay, and this is exactly what is called the error threshold. We can draw a little graph here. So let's suppose we start at low mutation rate, we increase the mutation rate, and so this is the fraction of the population that maintains this perfect state. Right? So there's a fraction of the population that has zero errors. If there are no mutations, of course, this fraction is equal to one. And as you increase the mutation rate, this fraction goes to zero. And then here there's a kind of critical mutation rate, if you will, which is just equal to F0, and then this fraction is zero beyond that. And this is true, so this picture is valid in the limit L to infinity. So as you take L to infinity, selection is able to maintain a finite fraction of the population at the fitness peak only if the mutation rate is smaller than the selection strength. I mean, this is sort of the very basic phenomenon of the error threshold. This is called the error threshold. Because if you think about these mutations as being replication errors, then if you have too many replication errors, then you cannot maintain your perfect sequence anymore. And I have a couple of pictures, so I don't have the projector today, but you know, I thought I could just show you this on the laptop. I mean, this looks almost trivial, right? But of course, what you should realize is that this is really a statement about the top eigenvalue of this matrix, but what really happens at this critical error threshold is that the entire spectrum undergoes a kind of phase transition. And this is what I wanted to show you in a couple of slides. Unfortunately, the quality of these scanned pictures is fairly poor. But, so the question is, do I even have it here? Because if not, so let's take 5 minutes break, and I'll just get my USB stick and I'll show it to you afterwards. Okay. Okay, so I want to say a little bit about the kind of biological interpretation of this. So what we see is that this error threshold is given by a condition on this total mutation rate. So in terms of the mutation rate per site, the statement is that the mutation rate per site is limited in order to maintain biological information. The mutation rate per site is limited by a factor divided by the sequence length, right? So that's sort of the interpretation here. Mu has to be less than we see, which is some constant. So in this case, it's 0 divided by L. And so this places a limit in some sense on the length of the genome, if you will. Okay, so this is limits the genome length. Assuming that the error rate, so the mutation rate per site, cannot be reduced indefinitely, and in fact there is some evidence that at least for certain classes of organisms that there is a kind of scaling between the mutation rate per site and the genome length, and this is in particular there's work by Drake, some papers by Drake. Which says that mu times L is approximately constant in certain classes of organisms. So for example, within RNA viruses, So that means if you want to make your genome longer, you have to reduce the error rate per site in order to maintain the biological information. Okay, so this was a simple calculation for a very specific fitness landscape where we just have one particular sequence that is fitter than all the others. Now the question is, how can you generalize this to other types of fitness landscapes, and there is a general result that gives you information about that, and I think this is quite informative, and it also has a kind of distinct physics flavor to it, and this is the so-called maximum principle. So this is now part 3, the maximum principle. And this is based on work by a number of people, but I think the most important paper was by Amazon and Carter in 2002. And so this gives you a general way of calculating this largest eigenvalue in the limit of L going to infinity for a general class of fitness landscapes. So let's consider fitness landscape, again a kind of permutation invariant fitness landscape. Form f of k. So what we want is a fitness landscape where the k dependent somehow scales with L. So we want this to be a function that we maybe call it G, which is a function G that depends on k over L. So this is the general form. And then the statement is that the leading eigenvalue for L to infinity, and again the same scaling as before, so U to 0 and U times L equals U being a constant, is given by this maximum principle, which reads like this. So lambda is equal to, or the limit of lambda for L going to infinity, is the maximum. So obviously we can consider this k over L as a new variable, which is now between 0 and 1. Right? So basically, we scale the number of errors by L, and then we get a variable that is between 0 and 1. And so we maximize with respect to this variable. And the quantity that we have to maximize is, on the one hand, of course, the fitness. And then there's a kind of entropy-like term, which is proportional to U, and which has this factor 1 minus 2 times x times 1 minus x square root. So this is what you have to maximize. And then you get the asymptotic lambda of lambda. So that allows you to calculate a lambda as a function of u. And in particular, lambda can have or as a function of g, and so as you change g and u, you can have phase transitions in lambda, right? So lambda can have discontinuous changes or singular changes, and this allows in particular to predict phase transitions in lambda, okay? Okay, so what does this mean? We try to interpret this a little bit. And so you see that, I mean, this is just a constant, but what you basically see is that you have the g term, and this is competing with something that is basically u times this square root factor. So if you look at this as a function of x, right, between 0 and 1, then this thing here is 0 at the boundaries and it's maximal at 1/2. So this kind of thing, right? So this is x times 1 minus x. And this has sort of strength u. And so it's something that favors x to be close to to 1/2, right? It's maximum at 1/2. And this is competing with the fitness function. And so again, if we have some general fitness function that tries to keep the error number of errors small, the stiffness function might, for example, look something like this, right? So this could be our g of x. And what you can sort of see is that and this is exactly the nature of the error threshold, and this is of course proportional to u. So this term should be u times u times this thing, right? U times x times 1 minus x. And so as you increase u, so if u is small, then the maximum of this object down here will be at 0 and will be localized at 0 errors. And as u increases, at some point the maximum will jump to this place and will have x equal to 1 half. And so that's sort of the nature, exactly the nature of the error threshold, the population goes from being localized near 0 to being delocalized and having just a random fraction of errors. And so you can interpret this as a kind of competition. Competition between energy corresponding to selection and entropy corresponds to mutations. And what the mutations do is to basically push you into regions of sequence space that have, just like in standard statistical mechanics, you're pushed into regions of sequence space that have sort of many representatives, right? So if you have if your error fraction is 1/2, then the number of sequences that have that error fraction is much bigger than if you have a small error fraction or an error fraction close to 1. So basically what is sort of being maximized here is some kind of sequence space volume. So this is completely analogous to thermodynamics or to statistical mechanics situation. So what I want to do for the remainder, I'd really like to try to do two things. So first of all, I want to show you a simple application of this idea, and then I want to give you a very brief sketch of how you can understand this. I mean, I'm not going to be able to derive this, but I can give you a kind of flavor which sort of goes into the direction of what Duccio just asked in the beginning, namely kind of continuum limit. So you can try to do a continuum limit, and then you can analyze something that looks like a Schrodinger equation and arrive at something that looks similar to this maximum principle. But let me first give you the application, which is, I think, quite instructive. I think we can actually keep this picture here, so the application. And this is something that has been advertised quite successfully under the name Survival of the Flattest. Of Survival of the Fittest by Darwin, and what it sort of means in sort of more serious terms is a statement about mutational robustness. And so what one considers is a simple generalization of the single peak landscape, where we say that in the single peak landscape, the idea is that every mutation immediately takes you away from the peak. So any mutation reduces the fitness by the same amount. Now, if you have a certain amount of mutational robustness, this means that you can tolerate a certain number of mutations, right? So you can tolerate some fraction x0 of mutations, but if you have more than that, then fitness goes to zero. So this is formalized in terms of the so-called Nisa landscape. So Nisa is a kind of flat-topped mountain, like in Arizona, so a mountain that has a flat top and then a steep cliff. So basically, in terms of this function g that I introduced, this would be a function that has fitness f0 up to a point x0, and then fitness drops to 0. So this would be a user landscape. And the bigger x0, the more robust this is, right? So large x0 means that you have large robustness. And so if you look at this construction, then basically you have to add this function to this Mieser landscape, and since the entropy term is, so x0 has to be less than 1/2, otherwise it doesn't make sense, so x0 is less than 1/2. And so since the entropy term is increasing with x, the maximum will always be given by the population sitting at x0, right? Because this, the fitness of the f0 term is constant up to this point, and the mutation term is increasing, and you add the two, and so the maximum, if you will, the population, the eigenvector, if you will, in this problem, will always be a population sitting right at the edge, because there it can take advantage of the entropy term, and it can take advantage of the energy term as well. So we see that for this problem, the prediction of the maximum principle is that lambda is equal to zero minus, so basically we have to evaluate the function in the maximum principle at x equal to x0. So it's just equal to this. So u times 1 minus 2 times x0 times 1 minus x0 minus square root. When u is less than uc, and of course if u is greater than uc, then the lambda will here be 0. If u is not equal to 0. Yes, it has to be 0. So that is if u is greater than uc. And so uc is simply obtained by putting this, so uc is equal to f0 divided by 1 minus 2 times x0 and 2 times x0. So this is the critical mutation rate. And what you can see is that it increases with x0. So x0 equal to 0 is the case that we had before, right? So if we have no robustness, then uc is equal to f0. But as you increase x0, this goes up. So the bigger your robustness, the more competitive you are in something. So this is sort of a quantification of this mutational robustness effect. And this means that, for example, as you increase the mutation rate, it can be the fitness of a flat and broad peak, or a fairly low and broad peak, can be higher than the fitness of a peak that is higher but more narrow. Right? So this means that you can have the mean fitness of the population. So maybe let me write this here. So basically there's a kind of trade-off. Selection strength and robustness. if we compare to different fitness landscapes, so the one that looks like this, for example, and another one that looks like this, right, so this would be a peak that has a large selection strength but low robustness, this has low selection strength but high robustness. Then there is a mutation rate, so at low mutation rates, of course, the species has a higher thickness here, but as the mutation rate increases, at some point there will be a transition where this fitness landscape has a higher fitness than this one. Right? So this increasing mutation rate. So this one is sort of favored at large. This one is favored at small. Of course, if U is greater than the critical mutation rate corresponding to this landscape, then the population will again be localized. But there's a kind of trade-off between robustness and selection. Okay, so that's sort of a general a message that comes out of this maximum principle. Is that clear? Okay, so let me finally discuss a little bit how you can understand this maximum principle in a kind of physical way. Okay, so the idea is the following. So we want to analyze this eigenvalue problem. All right, so let me write it down again. So we basically want to analyze this thing here. And we want to analyze it in the limit L going to infinity, and this f of k has this form g of k divided by L. Right? And so obviously this means that the difference between pk plus 1 and pk minus 1 will become small. So we'll make an ansatz. The obvious ansatz here is to say, okay, the solution of this thing will also have this kind of scaling form. So we assume that pk of star is some function of k over L. Right? It's equal to p of x, where x is an order and r is about 1. Right? And So the small parameter that we expanded is 1 over L, because 1 over L is just the difference between k plus 1 and k in these rescaled coordinates. And so you just insert this, and then you do a standard Taylor expansion up to order epsilon squared, and then you get the following differential equation. Just lambda p is equal to g of x times p minus epsilon, and u is, of course, again, u is equal to u times l, so this is a constant. So we have the first order derivative. We have a second order derivative. So this is what you get if you just do a kind of straightforward continuum limit here. And so you see that this is, and this is again where the, you know, the fact that the mutation matrix is not symmetric due to this lumping comes in, because we have this first order derivative. So it's not quite a Schrödinger equation because it has this drift term, right? Now to bring it into a standard Schrödinger form, one has to symmetrize it. And this can be done in the following way. So we can first look at the case when there is no selection. So let's suppose there is no selection. So g is equal to 0, so this term is absent, and then it's easy to find the solution to this equation. Then you find that the there's an eigenvalue 0, and then you just have to solve this equation. So there's a solution with eigenvalue 0 that is essentially Gaussian, centered around x equal to 1/2. Looks like this. So 1 minus 2x squared solves the equation with lambda equal to 0. And this is nothing, so this is a Gaussian centered around x equal to 1/2. What does this mean? This is, of course, simply the uniform distribution in sequence space. Right, so this is a something, so this p0 is centered around 1/2. So it looks something like this, and it has a width that is of order, square root of epsilon, so 1 over, square root of epsilon. So this is simply the sort of continuum version of the binomial coefficients. Right, this is a uniform distribution in sequence space. So essentially, in the discrete version, this would be 2 to the minus L times L over K. And so now, and this is sort of a trick that is known from the, for example, from the theory of proper Planck operators. So if you have this basic solution for the operator without this term, then you can symmetrize it by multiplying your wave function, so to speak, with this p0. So we can symmetrize it in the following way. So we introduce a function psi, which is almost a wave function, which is p0, the square root of p0 times this p. And then, and so this you can just check by inserting this into this differential equation. then you get something that is already essentially a Schrödinger equation. So you eliminate the first order term, this is what you want to do. So now we have a second order derivative, and we have a potential which I call V of x, and we have a shift in the eigenvalue by order epsilon. So this is what comes out, and this V of x, this is the essential point, this V of x is now u over 2 minus 2 squared minus g of x. Okay, so this is what this equation transforms to if you do this transformation from p to psi. And you see now that this looks like a Schrödinger equation with the following interpretation. So the V is a potential. The epsilon is something like Planck's constant. The U is the mass of the particle, or the inverse mass, and this is the energy. Right? So this is sort of now in a form that is what physicists like. And the most important thing is that the epsilon sort of is now multiplying this derivative term here, and that the V has changed. So the V is not just the fitness function, but the V also contains a piece from the mutational term. And this essentially comes from the exponent here in this Gaussian. Okay? And so now we have to remind ourselves what we actually want. We want to know the value of this eigenvalue here. We want to know what is lambda in the limit where epsilon goes to zero. Right? So the question is, what is lambda? And more precisely, of course, you know, this is a Schrödinger equation. Of course, it has a general spectrum. We're interested in the smallest eigenvalue, right? So we're interested in the ground state of this problem. I mean, lambda should be as large as possible, so the energy should be as small as possible. So we're interested in the ground state. Minus lambda for epsilon to zero. And so what is the ground state energy of a quantum particle in a potential when you take Planck's constant to zero? Actually, this is something I discussed with Roberto the other day, and he said it's you think about it in terms of heat bath, and you take the temperature to zero, it might not be so easy. What is the ground state energy of a quantum particle and a potential when you take the Planck's constant to zero? You know, you have potential V of x, right? And so at the quantum particle, the ground state wave function will be sitting here, right? Then you have two. Now you take Planck's constant to zero, what happens? So it just becomes sharper and sharper, and eventually it has to concentrate on the minimum of the potential. Right, so the ground state energy just becomes a minimum of the potential. And so obviously what you end up with is a minimum of B. And so lambda, so minus lambda will converge to the minimum of B of X, which is equal to the minimum of U over 2. Minus g of x. And so if you turn around the signs, then you end up with something that looks almost like the maximum principle that we wanted. Mm-hmm. Lambda is equal to the maximum of g of x minus u over 2 1 minus 2x squared. So we have something that looks that looks sort of similar, but it's not quite the same thing. compared to it's not quite the same thing, but what you can see is that this is actually so this is the expansion of that near x equal to 1/2. Right? So this is approximately the same as u over 2 and 1 minus 2x squared near x equal to 1/2. And so I mean, this is okay. So this is not something that I will be really able to explain to you. I think any more in any detail. But the point is that in this derivation, in this continuum limit, the way we have carried out the continuum limit, we have in some sense implicitly carried out the continuum limit near x equal to 1/2. I mean, it's sort of analogous to the way in which you derive the central limit theorem in probability theory. It will be valid up to order square root of n deviations, but it will not be valid over the whole range of the distribution. And so in order to get the correct version of the entropy term, you actually need to do a kind of a more refined kind of a continuum limit, which essentially amounts to a kind of, like, again, in sort of physics terms, it's similar to a WKD approximation. So you have to do a continuum limit which operates on the level of the logarithm of the wave function rather than the wave function itself. Let me just see if there's any way in which I can sort of
basically, it's a large deviation.
It's a kind of large deviation, yeah. So this is so this derivation was, you know, in the spirit of a kind of central limit approximation. I mean, because it's rather similar in the sense that what you're really doing is you're replacing this discrete object which contains binomial coefficients and so on. You replace it by a Gaussian. This is what we have done. Right? This is a good approximation if you're close to the maximum of the probability distribution, but it's not a good approximation of the tails. So you need to do a kind of more refined analysis. Let me just try to, okay, I think I can, you know, if it's okay to go on a few more minutes, I can try to sketch how that works. So we need a slightly more refined version of the continuum limit. And in fact, we can again start from this equation that is written here. Now it turns out, previously we did the continuum limit first, and then we symmetrized the problem by multiplying it with the square root of this Gaussian. But you can actually symmetrize it already on the discrete level. So symmetrize the discrete problem. And the way the symmetrization works is the same as before, so you have to multiply so that the same way as we previously multiplied with the square root of the Gaussian, now we have to multiply with the square root of the binomial coefficient. So we just introduce two k's, which are defined like this, and then we get something that looks essentially symmetric. Now the symmetrized discrete problem. And then we make a continuum limit, but not for the function itself, but for the logarithm of the function. So now we make a kind of continuum ansatz. So we write qk as before, we write qk as some function psi of k over L, but rather than considering the psi itself, we consider psi of x to be of the form e to the minus L times some function u of x. Right, so this is sort of, as I said, this is similar to a kind of WKE, because in the end, if you see, the limit L to infinity corresponds to h bar going to zero, so it's a kind of semi-classical limit. And so, if you remember from WKB theory, you know, you take your wave function and you write it as an exponent of something with an h bar in the denominator, and so the L here is in some sense our longer h bar. And then we take out the continuum limit for u, and what we get is then the following. There's the following problem, lambda minus g of x plus the mutation rate psi is equal to 2 times hyperbolic cosine times u prime, so this is now the function u times psi. Okay, so this is the equation that comes out from this continuum limit. So the so this is now in some sense the kinetic energy term, if you want. Right? So this contains a derivative of the wave function, but it sort of contains it in a form that is not very familiar. So if you want to bring it again into Schrödinger form, we have to expand this term. So if we expand this term, then this is approximately 1 minus 1 half d prime squared, right? But u prime, of course, is related to psi, right? So remember that the relation between psi and u is this one. And so using this relation, you can see that u prime squared, which comes in here, is in fact the same as or approximately equal to leading order minus epsilon squared times psi double prime divided by psi. And if you insert that here, you see that the psi cancels and you get something that is again epsilon squared psi double prime. So that gives you kind of a conventional kinetic energy term. And so the Schrödinger equation that you end up getting then looks like this. If we put these things together, then from here we find again a kind of Schrödinger equation, except that it now has, because of this term, it will have an x-dependent mass. Okay, so the Schrödinger equation that comes out looks like this. So there's a mass term here. Potential is now the, so to speak, correct potential, namely the one with the full with a full entropy term minus g of x. And the mass has the same kind of behavior, so the mass is 1 over 2 root times x. So you get a kind of quantum mechanical problem with this potential and with a position dependent mass. Okay, but of course for the argument of what happens for epsilon to zero, this position-dependent mass doesn't really matter. You take epsilon to zero, and again you end up at the ground state, which is just given by the minimum of V of x, and this is exactly the maximum principle that I described previously. I should of course say that the proof of this maximum principle by Hermisson et al. Didn't use this approach. I mean, this is something that we did later. They derive it in a completely different way, but this way you can sort of see how, where it comes from. So for epsilon going to zero, you recover the maximum principle. But what is sort of useful about this formulation is that it also allows you to calculate corrections. So and there, this position-dependent mass is important. So if you want to calculate corrections, this means that you have to actually look at the, you know, at the actual ground state wave function, there it makes a difference whether you're taking into account this position-dependent mass or not. So this corrections. one over L can also be calculated systematically. Details about that. So I can, there's a paper that we work on this subject that I can send to you afterwards for you to find the details. But this is sort of the basic idea. And this is where this maximal principle comes from. Okay. Okay, thanks. I think I'm done, because if you have any questions about the topic today or other topics, feel free to ask. I was just struck that maybe, you know, people would ask more questions if the camera wasn't there. Do you think that's true?
Yeah. Could be.
Do you feel intimidated?